Good morning and welcome to the National Gallery of Victoria. We're here on the banks of the Yarra River and we're here to check out the latest exhibition, the European Masters. We're here in one of the spaces here at the NGV and joining us is Laurie Benson, who you're one of the curators of this marvellous place which we're in at the moment. Now, first of all, very much behind us, we're looking at one of the paintings of the Städel exhibition. Tell us a little bit about this one here.
Well, this is a fantastic painting by Franz Marc, who's a German Expressionist painter. And most people think of German Expressionism as being quite heavy and, you know, really chunky kind of paintings and dark and meaningful and that. But Franz Marc was actually mainly an animalia, and which means most of his paintings were paintings of animals, because he had an attitude that animals were purer in spirit and pure in personality than most of the people he met. So he mainly concentrated on painting animals, and this is his dog Russi. Just a fantastic painting.
And it's certainly, you know, trying to keep him still enough, that's for sure, for that long to paint him. But
while sleeping, it's his dog, so he made him go to sleep probably. Yeah. Had let him have a lie down.
Right. Well, we're certainly in one of the spaces. Tell us a little bit about this general space that we're in at the moment.
This space is really the conclusion of the show. It is mainly German Expressionist paintings up to about 1950, which is where the show ends. But this is the German Expressionist section of the show. So we have the major early German movements, Laureato and De Brucke, who were mainly pre-World War I artists. Painting in Germany, and they're painting in the Weimar Republic, so there's a great freedom of spirit and a sense of possibility and great energy in a lot of the German Expressionist works. And even in a work such as Russi, you can see these great cubist forms, and there's just a real freedom of expression, a liberation of colour in particular, because obviously Russi's not yellow. Russi is actually white. I've seen photos. But it's about the spirit, and there's a real freedom in a lot of these paintings, and they're quite joyous.
Well, I suppose every single painting in this exhibition tells a certain story, and I'm sure you've got some favourites. Any particular favourites that stand out to you in this particular exhibition?
That's one of the toughest questions, because I know this sounds weird, but it really depends on my mood, and it depends what kind of mood I'm in. There is always a great story behind every painting, and usually my favourites are the ones I'm working on, because I unravel some of those stories, and so it changes pretty much on a daily basis. But there are some terrific things back further in the show, earlier works, the mid-19th century German paintings, so a lot of the artists are unheard of outside of Germany, but they're really fascinating and interesting stories.
And we're standing in front of Max Beckmann's double portrait. Now, this has a very interesting story. Tell us about it.
Yeah, this is one of those paintings that sort of belies the idea that German Expressionist painters are terribly serious and they have no sense of humour. But this is actually a really, really naughty painting. It's painted by Max Beckmann, who, of course, is Germany's greatest artist of the 20th century, but he was also working at the Städel Museum, and he was best friends with the director, Georg Swazinski. So what he did, he arranged to paint Swazinski's wife, bring her into the studio and paint her portrait.
Fair enough.
But as you would, but at the same time, he also invited Swazinski's mistress, his 18-year-old mistress, Carola, who was coincidentally Swazinski's personal assistant, invited her in to do a portrait as well. But the two women didn't know they were both having their portrait painted at the same time. And this one is fascinating because it's actually a precursor to Lord of the Rings.
All right.
What this knight in shining armour is trying to do is not actually attacking this woman. What he's trying to do is preventing her from placing on her finger a golden ring, which renders her invisible. But also the ring has a little bit of a corrupting influence as well. So obviously this resonates. This is where obviously a great inspiration for Tolkien, because it's a medieval German story. So it's fascinating. And one of the things I really like about it is because in the book and in the movies of Lord of the Rings, when Frodo and whoever pops the rings on, their clothes disappear. But in reality, or back in the medieval day, the woman who had the ring was always naked, so her clothes wouldn't need to disappear.
Now, how is the NGV seeing these younger generation coming through like us? Well, I mean, are we a bit of a challenge to look after?
No, not a challenge in any way, shape or form, because if we don't involve younger people in the art gallery and in the place, we're a dead institution. So we have to adapt. We have to make the place interesting for a whole range of ages, but particularly the next generation. They're absolutely critical to us, and that's why we try to get them as young as possible. We're developing kids spaces that are specifically for children. There's one, we've already opened one at NGVA in the Australian Gallery, and we're about to open one in NGVI. So we're trying to get engaged children at the youngest age so they're not intimidated by artworks.
Well, let's continue on through the exhibitions and through the museum and through the NGV.
It's a great painting.
Now, I'm intrigued by this because, I mean, you can read so much into absolutely anything. Do you think people read too much into art?
Some people can read too much into art. We sort of prefer to have some kind of factual basis or a documentary, a piece of documentation or a habit or a pattern by a particular artist. Now, we know that Hundekerter did do that sort of allegory with a lot of his paintings. So we try not to make up too many stories, but we don't have to most of the time.
Well, let's go for a bit of a wander.
Sure.
We're in the blue room, so to speak. Yeah. Sort of bluey-green, I've got to say.
Yeah, this is a room of our large-scale 17th century English and Italian and Spanish paintings in here. So we have the sort of big Baroque paintings are in this gallery, and they're some of the most spectacular paintings, like the chickens. They are absolutely wonderful and spectacular paintings.
Now, in this particular room, I mean, the size of some of these paintings, I mean, it just takes me back into as if I'm in a museum in Europe. I mean, there's just such an amazing collection that you've got here, and a very surprising collection for me. You know, you think, well, the NGV, it's got a number of quite significant artworks, but when you actually come here and you see them, they're quite spectacular.
We have the best collection, certainly, of European paintings, probably in the Southern Hemisphere, not just for Australia. And most of the works here in this room are really well-known works, and they've been published by scholars all around the world. They're very highly respected and regarded paintings. And nearly every work in here is a major work by a really important artist.
One of the major works here is The Banquet of Cleopatra. Now, what is it all about?
Well, you're right. This is probably the NGV's signature painting. It's probably the most famous painting in the collection because it's the masterpiece by one of the greatest 18th century artists, Italian artist Giambattista Tiepolo. But what is going on in this painting is called The Banquet of Cleopatra because it is Queen Cleopatra of Egypt, despite the fact that Tiepolo has updated the story, made it more relevant for his audience by putting the characters in contemporary costume, which makes it easier to relate to rather than, in big Egyptian garb. But the story has remained the same. It's Cleopatra holding a banquet for Mark Antony, who's a Roman general who's come to conquer Egypt, and she's trying to inveigle herself to his, she's trying to vamp him, she's trying to seduce him. And her method in this instance was to put on, she boasted she could put on the richest banquet in the history of mankind. And to make the dinner the richest dinner in history, she takes off from her ear, one of her earrings, which are the largest pearls known to man. So it's the largest pearl. And she waves it over this beautiful Venetian glass, and she drops it in this glass, which is actually a glass containing vinegar.
Oh, right.
With the idea that the pearl will be dissolved in the vinegar, and she drinks it. And of course, he is completely flabbergasted by this, and of course, instantly falls in love with her.
Well, thank you so much for joining us, Jane. It's real.
All right.
Thanks.
You.